Well, thank you for staying with us for the last session. This session is loosely defined between the question that concerns the relationship between the city and politics. I'm very glad to introduce Murray Fraser. He has gladly accepted to share the session, so I'm just going to very briefly introduce our presenters today. But just a few words about Murray Fraser. As you might know, he's a renowned professor, critic, architect. He was actually one of the founders of the AHRA, so it's a pleasure that he's here with us today. He has been following the AHRA events very closely, and he's also part, up until this year, of the steering committee. He's the director of postgraduate studies at the University of Westminster in the postgrad. And he has been recently more related to. He's more related to the Berlage. No. Is that correct?
It's absolutely right.
Well, anyway, it's a pleasure to have him with us today. So our three presenters are Maria Guidici here, Eva Eylers, and Ross Adams. Maria Guidici, she's pursuing her PhD at the Berlage Institute in Rotterdam. Her thesis reconsiders the architecture of the street. And her paper today is called Inconsiderate Hardness, Paris, Barcelona, 1853-1870. Eva Eylers, she's completing her PhD here, and her thesis concerns with the role of hygiene and health in modern urban planning. Her paper today is called The Modern Medical Institution and Its Role Within the City. And finally, Ross Adams, he's pursuing his PhD at the London Consortium, and his PhD examines the work of Ildefonso Cerdà with respect to the rise of urbanism and its relationship to government. His paper is titled Validad and the Total State, Political Theology of the Generic City. So I leave to Murray to begin the session, and Maria to begin with her presentation.
Good. Thank you very much. I want to very much, but just to say how delighted I am to be here. This is the eighth of the AHRA symposiums. I was fortunate enough to chair the first one at Westminster 7 years ago, and I think I'm the only person who's been to all of them. So I've been to every single one, and it's a delight. It's a really, really positive event. It's my favourite event of the AHRA programme, in the sense because you get to meet such bright emerging scholars. The standard I've always thought is incredibly high, and from what I've seen so far and what I've read of the papers you're about to hear, I think you'll agree that it's a very, very, very productive and very, very fruitful format. The papers here have got a certain linking theme. I think it's to do with the cities, the emergence of the industrial city, and rethinking about ways of how we might interpret that phenomena, and no doubt we'll be talking about that, and hopefully also talking about contemporary ramifications and things like that later on. I don't really want to say any more. I think the speakers really should obviously get on presenting their papers. So if it's okay, I'll pass over to Maria.
Okay, thanks a lot. I would like to start my presentation with this image that is taken from the Nouvelle Vague movie Last Year at Marienbad, because this image for me is representative of a key aspect of architecture, that is to say the relationship between the subject and the context, between city and man. If you can look at the image is very weird because while the people cast long shadows, the context, the trees, etc., doesn't. So this manipulation makes the contrast between architecture and subject very stark and very readable, and it makes us wonder ultimately whether architecture is really a human activity by default. Peter Eisenman has written at length on the demise of the humanist paradigm in architecture, explaining how in the contemporary architectural context, man has been kind of displaced from it being the center of his own universe to a kind of sort of lateral position. He's not seen as the originating element of the universe anymore, and the objects kind of acquire relevance that is independent of man. This situation that we can call post-humanism has been traced both by Michael Hayes and Eisenman back to the art debate of the 1920s. But actually, I would like to discuss what is for me the real beginning of the post-humanist paradigm that I personally read in the city projects of the mid-1800s, so especially the transformation of Paris by Haussmann and the expansion of Barcelona by Ildefonso Cerdà. Inconsiderate hardness was for Georg Simmel the hallmark of the life in a modern metropolis, a metropolis that Simmel saw as decidedly post-humanistic already. And this discussion is part of my thesis on the architecture of the street. And why is that? Because what I'm interested in the architecture of the street is the idea of city as symbolic form and the construction of the modern subject. Symbolic forms are, for Ernst Cassirer, the categories of the consciousness of objects, a characteristic Weltanschauung that takes form out of the chaos of impressions. And I think it's very clear to see how the city, until at least Haussmann and Cerdà, was thought, built, and conceived as a symbolic form, while the link between symbolic form and construction of the city gets more and more lost in an attitude that becomes more and more managerial after the explosion, let's say, of the industrial city. So Paris and Barcelona. I would like to discuss these two paradigmatic cases, especially starting not really from the architecture, but from two books. The books that the two authors of these plans have written post facto to explain the reasons of their own work. They are two very different works because the memoir by Haussmann is the conventional kind of autobiography of a bureaucrat, of an administrator, while on the other hand, Teoria Generale by Cerdà, who believes himself to be a scientist, is a sort of scientific treatise in which Cerdà tries to back up his theory with data, basically, with scientific inquiry. And in this sense, these two men that were not only contemporaries, but that were also contemporaries, for example, between the others of Darwin and Marx, are really part of a wider debate in which the life processes are seen more and more in a reified form. Also, the discourses of biology and political economy really seeped through in the way urban planners basically see their own work. And life is really seen more in the quantifiable, statistic, materialistic aspects rather in the transcendental aspects that were up to then common hallmarks of the idea of the city as symbolic form, let's say. First of all, Paris. Paris is seen by many authors actually as the epitome of the humanistic city, but I would like to problematize a bit this kind of cliché and look actually for the real inconsiderate hardness that we can read in the Transformation of Paris by Haussmann, that for 17 years has acted as prefect of the Seine region, gutting the medieval tissue of the center of Paris, with a network of wide thoroughfares with a decidedly theatrical character that put basically stage a sort of mise-en-scène of the choreography of fluxes of a budding industrial city. We always discuss Haussmann talking about boulevards, but actually I believe that the archetype that Haussmann really used in his transformation of Paris is the archetype of the avenue. And why is that? I think it's really interesting because the avenue is not an urban type, but it's actually a suburban or kind of conception, at least when it was first put forward in the 1600s. And it's a wide tree-lined thoroughfare that links the city with the landscape, with the countryside, basically. Of course, it starts from the city, but it has a wider ambition, wider territorial ambition, let's say. That is linked for me to the famous motto of Loger, we should look at the city as if it were a forest, which of course is very far from being an idyllic take on the idea of city, but it rather really dissolved the city into a kind of continuous carpet of productive potential, ultimately. The first case, actually, of use of the avenue on a large scale has been made by the Minister of Transportation of Henry IV, who basically did nothing else but simply planting elm trees regularly on the thoroughfares that connected Paris to the rest of the country, constructing a very simple but very consistent architectural language that linked towns, estates, gardens, productive landscape, and city into a whole continuum. So you can very easily understand that even if Haussmann or Sully never talked about urbanization, they already saw the city not as a point of exception, but as one point within a network of productive potential that is more or less homogeneous, let's say, with simply points of intensity. You can see here, I don't know if I can point it out, that the boulevard being put on the old city walls works more like a hinge between the consolidated center and the expansion of the city, while the avenue, being mostly radial, as in this case, really works as a sort of settlement principle for a continuous expansion of the city in the landscape, ultimately. And from Paris, ideally, these avenues would manage the whole productive body of France, let's say. Also, the interesting thing of the avenue is that it's a highly theatrical kind of urban artifact, because through the use of perspective and the repetition of trees, basically really aims at constructing a sort of perspective scene, an aspect that has been, between the others, underlined by landscape critic J.B. Jackson, for example, between the others. So to wrap it up, I would say that really the theatricality of Hasmans Boulevard is extraordinary because it doesn't come from architecture, from traditional monumentality, like as you can see here, for example, in squares and so on and so forth, but it comes from an idea of productive landscape imported in the city. And for me, this already problematizes highly the idea that we usually have of Haussmann as the, like, really the climax, let's say, of city building in the 1800s, because it has paradoxical sides. The theatricality that Haussmann uses is not the traditional theatricality that banked on the ritual, the festive, the cathartic, and the exceptional, but it's more like a sort of spectacle that puts on the stage really the productive potential of an industrial metropolis. On the other hand, if this is the archetype that Haussmann used, it would be interesting also to discuss and to problematize a bit the idea that we always pre-received that Paris was conceived as a sort of consistent, hierarchical, figurative plan. Of course, at first glance, this seems true, but actually, if we read the memoir of Haussmann, we find out that the way he really put in place all these transformations was a very case-by-case sort of kind of process, actually. It's simply linking points of intensity that were, in most cases, already there, sometimes creating some of them, like, for example, the opera. But mostly, he followed a kind of ready-made urbanism, if you want, that we can already trace back to the Sisu's fifth plan for Rome in the 1500s. The difference being this, very early on in his papacy that lasted only 5 years, Sixtus V already had in mind that he could transform Rome simply by linking architectures that were already there, so with a very, very simple and opportunistic kind of strategy. Nevertheless, it was a strategy, because very early on we have already this drawing that said that already sort of prefigured what he was expecting of the plan once realized. While this, that is one of the earliest representations of all the transformations that Haussmann operated in Paris, is actually a plan that in itself does not exist. It's something that has been drawn as a drawing only afterwards. If we read really the memoirs of Haussmann, it's really possible to see that these operations were only carried forward one at a time. I mean, he never had the complete whole canvas of the thing. He was really a bureaucrat, and he really took a sort of a kind of, let's say, tactical, opportunistic operation rather than a strategy. You know, the strategy usually is a way of thinking that is a spatial way of thinking. It's not really concerned with the matters of time, more with a general kind of laying out of the situation. While on the other hand, tactics are more concerned with the performance, with the kind of act that is required to ultimately win a battle, not a war, but a battle. So he started by these first two roads that were for him the Carpe and the Decumanus of the New Paris, and he went on describing this series of star-shaped hubs that nowadays look very figurative, of course, very hierarchical, but they were not really thought that way. They were actually the result more of a kind of performance. And I think that if we put together this idea of the avenue as extra urban artifact imported in the city, together with this kind of highly opportunistic tactical way of moving of Haussmann, we can really ask ourselves what was at stake ultimately in this epitome of the humanistic plan. Well, it was of course the idea of the milieu, of constructing an environment that was of course targeted at the creation of a very specific political subject. The very idea of political subject is controversial because subject is on the one hand a member of a state that owes allegiance to a monarch or a ruler, but on the other hand is also something that has got to do with agency, because we can mean by subject a thinking or feeling entity, the conscious mind. Let's say, so every time that we discuss what is a political subject, I think that it's never like really a neutral operation, especially when the subject is especially the citizen, as in the case of course of city planning. Citizenship has been defined through the ages in very different ways. I mean, the right to citizenship has been based on very different parameters according to different societies, let's say, from the ethnic background of the Greek polis to the modern metropolis, where your ability to offer your own labor potential is really the only prerequisite for a person to be accepted as a citizen in a city. So ultimately what happens is that this is the subject that is put forward by Haussmann. It's a subject that has lost any kind of ties to traditional values, any kind of ties to even the traditional kind of take on theatricality, or on performance, on catharsis, on the ritual. It's really the most reified subject possible. And why is that? It's because, of course, this thing happens at the rise of biopower, that is a way to enhance, render productive, compose, maximize, and administer life. So basically, to see the subject only in virtue of the only one aspect that is really relevant for a subject in the modern metropolis, that is precisely its potential to produce. So since one aspect of life, production, becomes more relevant than all the others, spiritual, personal, individual, and so on and so forth, a process of reification of the subject necessarily entails. A process that Georg Simmel again called the blunting of discrimination. He said that in this case, the meaning and differing values of things, and thereby the things themselves, are experienced as insubstantial. So you can understand that this whole situation is very paradoxical, because on the one hand, there is a process of reification, which means that all kind of transcendental values are gradually discarded. But on the other hand, the material qualities of the physical things also loses more and more importance, because anyway it's flattened into this kind of generic choreography of production. As a kind of counterpart, very briefly, to this idea of performance, theatricality, and productive potential that Hosman put forward, I would just briefly hint to the kind of sister project of Hosman, that is the project of Barcelona by Ildefonso Cerdà. We all know, of course, that the project of Barcelona is based on a grid, but just to problematize the idea of grid, the archetype of the grid, that is something that is seems very obvious, I would like to put forward the thesis of art historian Rosalind Krauss, who discussed grids in visual art, saying that the first grids that we can trace back in visual arts don't belong to modernist painting, but actually belong to symbolist painting, where the window really becomes the kind of physical interface between the self and the context. So it's really, again, about a discourse that really relates on the idea of what is the distance between the subject and the context. So in the case of Cerdà, I think that this hint to Krauss's theory should lead us to a bit problematize what seems the inconsiderate hardness of Cerdà's grid. This is, I think, a nice paradox. On the one hand, we have the Hosman star-shaped hubs that seems everything but hard. I mean, they seem very theatrical, etc., but they actually embody a choreography of production. And on the other hand, we have Cerdà's grid that seems a model of inconsiderate hardness, but actually lends interesting, I think, surprises if we look at it in detail. I'm not going to discuss the project, just to hint at the Teoria Generale, that is basically the treatise with which Cerdà both wanted to justify his own project for Barcelona, and on the other hand, to use it as a case study, as a kind of paradigm, to sustain, especially through statistics, his own proposal. And it was aimed ultimately at putting forward urbanization, that is for Cerdà, both a science, a way of knowledge, basically, and a practice and a physical artifact that for him would ultimately substitute the city as we knew it. And I think that this act of putting forward an alternative to the city is a very interesting kind of act, because it's not only about practical, functional kind of ideas. It's really about, again, redefining a subject. And why is that? Well, because first of all, he refuses the word ciudad. Ciudad, or cité in French, is a juridical word that has no relationship with a real place or territorial setting, and it has nothing to do with urbs. Already this definition was already in place in the 1500s by Jean Baudin, that is one of the main theorists of sovereignty in Renaissance France. And the same kind of theme is brought forward by Cerdà when he says that the genuine meaning of urbs referred to the material part of the buildings, while the Romans used the word civis for everything that concerns the subjects. So basically, he cancels the subject. He says, I'm not going to use ciudad, I'm not going to refer to the civis anymore, I'm just going to concentrate on the material grouping of buildings, the way he wants to put it. Of course, this he did also with a project to enlarge Barcelona outside the city wall, with a competition that he didn't win, but another project that banked on much more, let's say, conventional hierarchical figures. What he wanted to do very clearly was simply to redistribute the real estate value throughout the new expansion. That was a project that was, of course, utopian in economical terms, but radically realist in its embracing the new scientific technologies. But for me, what is interesting, what is relevant to my thesis in all this, is the fact that he wanted to ruralize the city to urbanize the countryside. So once again, as in the case of Hosman, there is this very weird and very, for me, disquieting kind of element of the landscape let's say, dissolving the traditional boundaries of the city. somehow this fact that the landscape and the city are collapsed into the same thing, it's as if you were saying basically that the city is not the seat of transcendental values anymore. It's not something exceptional anymore. And of course, the interesting thing in all this that seems up to here very dry, if you want, or very radical, is actually the fact that Cerdà links back to an extremely interesting archetype that is actually the Roman city. What he says here is that urbanization comes from the furrow traced by the sacred oxen in the founding rituals of ancient Rome. So he refers really to a ritual, which is extraordinary, I think, for a scientist. Roman cities mostly used grids and managerial devices, but at the same time, the layout of a Roman city was never purely practical, always influenced by religion and rituals. The city was to be the cosmological analog of a celestial order. The founding ritual was based on the marking of a precise perimeter that represented the earthly mirror of a heavenly configuration, something that was based, of course, on the shadows projected in certain moments of the day, which meant that the layout of the city would vary depending on the latitude of the position of the site. So I think what is interesting here is that while this ritual might seem irrational, obscure, absurd to us, actually it set a sort of method for the foundation of all the cities throughout the extent, let's say, of Roman influence that was actually very readable. So it was in a way also a pedagogical device because any Roman citizen could understand the method with which his own city had been founded. They were all colonies. Colonies as were, of course, the Spanish colonies in the Latin America, that, of course, were part of the baggage of knowledge that Cerdà as a Spaniard had. But I think there is a big difference because this grid worked more like an ideogram, a direct symbol of rationality and control, while Cerdà had in common certain things with his attitude, didn't attach this kind of transcendental value to the idea of city. So. Basically, what I think is interesting is that they both wanted to teach how to live in a city, to the heathens, for example, in the case of the Spaniards in Latin America, and to the new heathens that are basically the industrial workers brought in the city by Cerdà, but in very different ways. Of course, this one is highly symbolic, while in the case of Cerdà, it's completely different because he wants to build a heuristic device. Heuristic device is basically a tool to find out something, supposedly to find out something about this thing itself, about what is outside the window that we were seeing before. And he aimed at achieving this pedagogical task by making the manzana, the urban block, una urbe elemental. So in his idea, the house and the block, the city and the urbanization at large, would be tied together by a system of analogies that would build up an educational apparatus. So analogy likens a physical object, something that can be experienced with the senses, to something immaterial. Through the knowledge of their own houses, the inhabitants of Barcelona would ultimately have access to the immediate knowledge of the city at large. Of course, also through the repetition and the variation of this kind of model. What happened in the end that he aimed at defeating the market, aiming at a sort of garden city that we can see here. The market, of course, defeated him by highly densifying the model. This is what actually happened. So it's a plan that is both failed and highly successful. Highly successful because even if it has been realized in a completely different manner, it still embodies the same kind of pedagogical attitude. And as a final side note, I would like to show you something. This street here and this here, that are two of the main new thoroughfares of the city, are placed exactly on the position of the meridian and the parallel that run through Barcelona. Of course, this has got to do with sun exposure rules, but also with the fact that Cerdà took very seriously the parallel with the Roman city, and in a way, he registers a sort of cosmological scale into his very practical plan. So what binds together Haussmann and Cerdà's project, I think it's clear by now. It's the fact that at the very peak of humanistic culture, they become inherently post-humanist, accepting a reification of sort of the context, but nevertheless aiming for a new kind of consciousness of the subject. It's what in neo-vanguardist literature has been called opacity, or a form of reification that lets the things speak for themselves. An extreme acceptance of alienation of the metropolitan life, but not geared towards the annulment of conscience, but rather through a new kind of conscience. So again, to close with Georg Simmel, the metropolis has always been the seat of money economy. Money economy implies a matter-of-fact attitude in dealing with men and things. That, of course, implies the inconsiderate hardness. So this is a process of reification. All aspects of life are reduced to one object, money, but at the same time the object is so abstract that it is impossible to draw any material qualitative differences between objects. That's why also the subject is flattened somehow. That's why also the Nouvelle Vague that we were seeing before said that we don't want to talk about the character anymore. We don't even want to discuss the subject anymore because there is no subject. Our era is actually the era of the matriculation number, not the era of the subject. So ultimately, that would be my final hint. I would wonder whether by turning the focus to the object, to their spectacle, to the city seen as a landscape, as in the case of Osmai and Serda, we cannot rebuild the rich relationship between objects and subjects, and in short, whether the humanist city is really the only human city that we can imagine.
Well, I speak about modern medical, the modern medical institution, and its role within the city. So changing ideas of health and disease have a long history of influencing the thinking and planning of the built environment. This influence can of course be traced back to ancient times, to Vitruvius or the Roman Empire. With the specialized medical institution, however, the relationship between the disciplines of medicine and architecture developed into a very close alliance. My PhD thesis looks particularly at the ways in which the spatial organization and architecture of the tuberculosis sanatorium, which emerged as a distinct medical institution in Europe in the 19th century, developed over time. One aspect of my research is tracing the role of the modern medical institution for the city. The modern health institution was not only a therapeutic environment, one could say a refuge for the individual, but the sanatorium was also a servicing space, at least temporarily ridding or purifying the city and its population of dangerous elements. And it is this important function of the institution I would like to talk about in more detail today. Towards the end of the Middle Ages, two great models of medical organization were known in Western society. One was engendered by leprosy, the other one by the plague. The plague was faced by a system of internal control, which Michel Foucault calls the military type of quarantine, because military inspection served as its model. This system was put in place in order to detect the dangerous elements within the city. It was a generalized system of surveillance that compartmentalized and controlled the city, which was supposed to enable the systematic search and recording of infected individuals. On the other hand, there's the religious type of quarantine, the simple removal or exclusion from society, which was originally engendered by leprosy. Already in biblical times, the people affected by leprosy were mandated by this kind of exclusion. And again, according to Foucault, also during the Middle Ages, in wide parts of Europe, any discovered leprosy case was to be expelled immediately from the common space, the city, and exiled to a gloomy, ambiguous place where his illness would blend with that of others. Comparable to a surgical action, the unwanted elements were thus removed from the body of society. For the religious model of exclusion, we find a perfect example also in the so-called ship of fools. Here it was not the leper, but the madman who should be excluded, and loaded with passengers who were believed to be out of their mind and therefore unwanted in the cities, the Narrenschiffe traveled the Rhineland. Despite the important role the Narrenschiffe played in art and literature, this ship was not only a literary invention. It was instead, and I quote, common practice for towns to banish the mad from inside the city walls, and such trips were organized and even paid for by cities. Around 1400, the arrival in the great cities of Europe of these ships must have even been a common sight. During the 17th century, however, it were not only the carriers of contagious diseases or supposedly mad people who were believed to constitute a threat to the city. Also, individuals who were demented or misshapen could expect internment,
and were mandated by what Foucault calls the medicine of exclusion or medical exclusion. The urban environment was here to be purified by a mechanism of expulsion where medicalizing an individual meant separating him and in this way purifying the others. For this purpose, the city was in need of a space that served as a disposal for the unwanted elements. Historically, this space was placed either at the outskirts or completely outside the realm of the city. With the leper colonies, such a space could be constituted by an island or even a guarded cave. But as we have seen with the Ship of Fools, also a traveling space of exclusion could be imagined. Since also the dead came to be believed to constitute a danger to the permitted elements of the city, around 1750, it was not only individuals who were to be separated and exiled from the city, but also complete service structures. Necessary for the city, yet at the same time a potential danger, graveyards, slaughterhouses, but also hospitals were displaced and removed to the city's periphery, far enough from the center, but still reachable. The space of exclusion would therefore not only serve as a container for contagiously ill people, but could be expanded according to whatever was agreed as constituting a threat to the present authorities, according to an ever-changing determination of who or what was still acceptable within the city and what was not. The mechanism of expulsion came also to be employed on a variety of people who were hospitalized in the Hotel Dieu in Paris in the 18th century. With its origins reaching back to the 7th century, however, this general hospital, which Nicolas Pevner calls the largest and most famous, or rather infamous, of all hospitals, was not placed at a distance, but constitutes a space of exclusion at the very heart of the city. As we see, it stood west of Notre Dame, and in its, I quote Pevner, monstrous 17th century development extended across the south arm of the Seine and onto the south bank. While, for example, the leper colony interned only one specific group of people, the Hotel Dieu was not at all specialized. The mad, the sick, the poor, or simply the old, the Hotel Dieu hosted all of them. Once stored away, these elements were no longer considered necessary or of any consequence to their surroundings. This perception, however, changed when the storage space itself became conceived as dangerous. After by 1772, fires had destroyed much of the hospital, a group of health commissioners of the Académie des Sciences were asked by the authorities to examine the problem Hotel Dieu. These health commissioners, or the health commissioner's report, severely criticized the hospital, since it was understood as being highly insalubrious. The authors denounced that, I quote, infectious diseases are not separated, and the insane are the next door neighbors of the surgical cases, and would therefore disturb them with their constant screaming. It probably not only took the insane to disturb the surgical cases. Tenon, a surgeon and member of the Académie des Sciences, describes the room where the operations took place as most terrifying. For in the same room lay also those to be operated on next day and those operated on the day before. You can imagine. Overcrowding was the most serious problem. Still in the 1790s, Stieglitz exclaimed, I quote, "How infinitely cruel is the way they pack four or six unfortunate patients in one bed." La Rochefoucauld-Liancourt, in his report, made it six or even eight to one bed. And Cuvier wrote about the inmates, "The suffering in hell hardly surpasses those of these unfortunates, one packed above the other. They cannot breathe, and sometimes even feel one or two dead bodies amongst them." And indeed, the Health Commissioner's report in 1787 estimates for the 2,000 patients of the Hotel Dieu a mortality rate of 1 in 4. The confinement which had brought together the sick, the mad, and the vagabond was therefore not only unspecific, but proved also highly mortal. Yet this disorder and salubrious condition that led to high mortality rates concerned not only the inside of the building. Referring again to the report of the health commissioners, Blandine Barret-Kriegel speaks of the insalubrité à l'extérieur par l'effet d'éjection de l'hôpital sur la ville, which I could not really translate. Let's say the building caused insalubrity to its exterior. Barret-Kriegel speaks further of the walls of the hospital transpiring and spreading what was supposed to be contained within onto the city. We have seen a similar version in Maria's paper. I hope you recognize Paris, right? So the report again criticizes, for example, the washing of the patient's linen in the Seine. To explain, the miasma was believed before the discovery of germs and bacteria to be the main carrier of diseases. And through this washing of the linen, the death-bringing miasma would not only be affecting the simple people, but by means of the water could be transported into the very center of power. I quote from the report, into the fountain in the middle of the royal court, which we see, which then was still, despite the king being in Versailles, but when he was in Paris, he was still at the Louvre. So the Hotel Dieu had thus been considered useful to the city of Paris until it came to be perceived as a proliferator of disease. It concerned not only the interned, which would have been negligible at the time, but also its urban environment. The building, the container, was leaking. What could be considered an architectural problem, the establishment of a sturdy physical borderline segregating the interior of the Hotel Dieu from its surroundings, had turned into an urban problem. It seemed that the system of absolute exclusion did not work unless one was ready to use a great and also costly amount of physical force, both in terms of physical fencing and the provision of human guards to secure the space of exclusion. However, after the experience with the Hotel Dieu, it could not be a question anymore of how well this construct would work, but of how little it would fail. Therefore, the Hotel Dieu, instead of disburdening the city, came to be considered a serious danger to its surroundings. This perception triggered a rethinking of the task of the hospital in general. The hospital had to be reformed and its aims in relation to the city, but also its users, redefined. In the 15 years following the fire, a number of propositions for a new Hotel Dieu were put forward. We can distinguish between two main tendencies or ideas to reform the hospital plan. One was the pavilion, the other the radial plan. In their report, the commission had pleaded for no more than 36 beds in a ward, all single beds, iron bedsteads, and iron window frames. The single patient should be granted more space, while the overall space should be used more efficiently. Since a lack of ventilation was then believed to be the main reason for the high mortality, health commissioners, but also doctors like Tenon, in collaboration with architects, were particularly aiming at an improved ventilation of the wards. We can see that here where in the center of this ventilation tower basically dominates the entire design of the hospital. In 1785, two architects, amongst them Bernard Poyer, who was contrôleur des bâtiments to the city of Paris, suggested a radial plan like we see Dr. Petit had done 10 years earlier. But where Petit had 6 radii and 2,000 beds, Poyer proposed 5,000 beds. While both suggested this radio plan solution, already 1 year after the fire in 1773, Jean-Baptiste Leroy, a scientist, suggested rebuilding on a plan which then would determine most of the future of the hospital, with single-story wards parallel to each other. And therefore he chose an arrangement which should particularly improve ventilation. What the various propositions all have in common, I'm sorry we don't have time I think to look at the plans in more detail, is that they suggested to choose a different, less populated site for the hospital. Suggestions were the Plaine de Belleville, close to today's Parc de la Villette, or the Plaine de Grenoble, which is close to the École Militaire. But most propositions choose the Île des Cygnes, an island in the Seine, today nearby the Eiffel Tower, but which was then very much at the city's periphery. And this choice had its logic in the direction of the flow of the River Seine. If we look again at the map, with this solution, the water would transport the hospital's debris out of the city instead of distributing it in the very center. Therefore, these plans not only speak of the efficient distribution of the interior space of the hospital, but they also demonstrate that the building was understood more in terms of its relationship to its surroundings. Blandine Barret-Kriegel's study of the hospital as facility emphasizes how through the reports contemplating the alternatives to the general hospital, the difference between the inside and the outside of the building was erased, and the rules formally applied to of urban space. Barret-Kriegel considers that general principles, especially when it comes to the principles of dispersion and circulation of air, in the report provided by the health commissioners, could apply to different scales, from the body of the patient to the room to the city. The health commissioners compared, for example, the amount of air that was available to each patient. With this, they would associate the degree of mortality with different spatial qualities of the hospitals and even of the different rooms. The correct distribution and circulation of air and people became equally important for the scale of the city as for the building. Therefore, according to, again, Barret-Kriegel, to solve the problem of health, it was not enough to reform the hospital, even to the point of perfection. It became necessary to also reorganize the entire hospital system and to adapt it to the system of the city. The moment of the fire at Hotel Dieu can be considered as a fundamental rupture. The hospital came to be coined a machine, an instrument of service and of cure. Up to that point, the dominant view of a hospital building as a space that isolates and imprisons the disease and the diseased was substituted with a project of a public facility that would respond to the needs of the health of the population. We have established that this new definition was partly an answer to the hospital's dreaded effects on its surrounding. This understanding of the population, however, includes or targets the hospitalized elements that were once interned, usually neglected. The hospital was now supposed to service both the city and the sick, to be an instrument of care and of cure. What caused this changing understanding of the individual, which now, as a member of the population, should be looked after? What caused this changing understanding of the individual, which now, as a member of the population, should be looked after? And what made this individual valuable, however, cannot be discussed today. Coming to the end. Again, I did not have the time to examine these various different plans which were proposed to replace the notorious hospital in more detail, which are, you know, in itself, each of them very interesting. What is interesting, I think, looking at this entire episode of the Hotel Dieu, is that the city itself seems to have resisted the space of exclusion, which opposes the inner logic of the city as a space which should enable for mutual benefit. So to summarize, we could say that with the end of the Ancien, regime came another way of organizing the interior space of the hospital. This new organization would focus on appropriating the hospital as a space of efficient medical care, but also as another way of conceptualizing the hospital within the city. This rethinking of the space of the Hotel Dieu allowed for the modern health institution to become a hinge between city, state, and population. It then also became a space where active research was confronted with established medical knowledge, and it offered a space for the constant thinking and renegotiating of these relationships. What concerns us most, however, is that it offered a space for the rethinking of architecture, which was believed to have an imminent role in the shaping and ordering of these relationships. To end with Sven Olaf Wallenstein, it can be even seen as a kind of laboratory for the testing of these new ideas, which are then extended to the whole of urban space. And to really end with a bit of an anticlimax, maybe, this is actually what was built about 100 years after all this discussion happened. Thank you very much.
To warn you, I'm also going to be talking a bit about Cerda today, so I'll try to not repeat anything that Maria has already very clearly explained. Skip through some things. The title of my paper is Validad in the Total State, Political Theology of the Generic City. But to first give a kind of brief context or outline the context of this talk, I just wanted to look at a few examples of some imagery produced by AMO, Rem Koolhaas, recently. Perhaps you're familiar with this. This is from the World Energy Report, or Energy Report, I'm not sure. And what I think is interesting about this is that it represents, to me, it shows that we're at a point in time where, on the one hand, the whole world can be sort of seen as one giant kind of population, one sort of homogenous society which can be parsed up based on the sort of resources present in each region. And on the other hand, it shows that the same population needs to be managed through a sort of infrastructural network. And in a way, it represents that our imagination of the city, of the way we think about the world, et cetera, cannot be determined without infrastructure. Or we cannot imagine the world somehow without the determination of infrastructure, if you will. But anyhow, I'm going to be talking about Ildefonso Cerda, who, as we know, is a Spanish engineer, most famous for his design of the reform and extension of Barcelona on the left, and his seminal text, the Teoría General de la Urbanización of 1867. I'm interested in his work because much more than figures like Haussmann, I think Cerda's design and theoretical writings exude a much richer and clearer relationship between modern politics and the design of the city. That's a relationship that is consistently overlooked today, yet seems increasingly relevant into contemporary globalized state of urbanization, which in fact is a term he coined in 1861. In part, this lapse is due to Cerda's fairly recent and still scant rediscovery, quote, from historical oblivion. His work was almost unknown to the architectural discourse until the mid-70s. And it still has not yet been widely translated. In any case, I'm not going to talk at length about Cerda the figure, but instead I want to talk about a specific concept of his that he developed early on in his theoretical writings, which I think reveals a certain political and indeed theological disposition of his work, one which would occupy the center of his theory of urbanization and would in fact anticipate the way many architects and urbanists continue to think about the city today. This concept is what he called vialidad. Crudely, this translates to circulation or conveyance, but as we will see, it bears much more meaning than this. So again, the teoría. Well, Cerda's work was clearly project-based. His real drive, unlike any of his contemporaries, increasingly aimed to construct a singular unitary theory, a universal model from which modern society could conceive of cohabitation anew. His theory of urbanization as such drew from more of a sense of moral and philosophical duty than from an interest in reconstructing any particular city. Serda's mission was to not only create an urbanizing science, as he called it, but to fully reconceptualize the very notion of the city itself, as Maria mentioned. And indeed, this was his first task. So again, from ciudad to urbe. He drew, in that case, from the sort of material economic administration governed by a private sphere of familial life to found this notion of urbe again. But it was also an effort to fully strip the city of its political signification. So the urbe would be a model reduced to the imminent fact of domestic cohabitation, i.e. rest and movement, and constructed on the convenience of these elemental necessities, consisting solely of the single-family dwellings and a network of circulation connecting them. As opposed to the ciudad, the city, the remnant of centuries of political abstraction, the urbe would no longer be confined by its artificial limitations, city walls, etc., obstacles, insalubrious passageways, and all the rest of it. It would be instead a model which would fully embrace the technological developments of circulation in all of its forms, distributing them across a grid of repeatable, interchangeable units. His theory would see the urbe as a universal, infinitely expandable fabric of communication, mobility, exchange, and dwelling. Each block would integrate multiple systems of infrastructure, conceptually mirroring the constitution of the entire city itself. Services, green spaces, resources, kiosks would now be allocated in uniform distributions across the grid. It would be a concept which alone would overcome the division between the urban and the rural, again, as Maria mentioned, incorporating measured parcels of the latter into the former, what he called ruralized urbanization. Indeed, the term urbe denoted a universal idea of interconnected human settlement, free from the burden of limitation and scalar specificity altogether, and one whose ultimate achievement would be the occupation of the entire globe, seamlessly interconnecting whole regions of it into a single urbe. He saw no difference between two dwellings sharing a common sort of reciprocal relationship and a kind of entire, you know, city stretching across the globe. They're both urbes for him. While it seems that many of Serda's ideas reverberate in the later work of figures like Hilbersheimer, Leonidov, Le Corbusier, and many others, clearly key figures of modernity, his written work speaks perhaps more intimately, if not directly at times, with figures like Hobbes, Locke, Rousseau, and Kant. Indeed, one could argue that his entire oeuvre is nothing less than an attempt to recover and complete the project of enlightenment. Throughout his various theorias, he wrote several, the Kantian influence is hard to overlook, from his emphatic drive toward a universal conception of history to a shared desire for the establishment of perpetual peace, to an unwavering belief in civilization governed by the rational force of law, to even certain notions of nature as a kind of caretaker of civil society. In fact, the very hypothesis of urbanization itself can stand in as a realization of Kant's notion of cosmopolitan purpose, a drive that is innately inscribed within the human being's capacity for technological innovation. Moreover, his theoria is at once a theory for the future of the form of urban cohabitation, while at the same time it stands as a critique of the Enlightenment itself, a criticism based on its failure to advance its goals into the material realm of human cohabitation. So just as Kant had responded to the growing political crisis of the time with his What is Enlightenment, Serda's theoria responded to the mid-19th century's own plight, a period in which a general urban crisis had reached a tipping point for which a bloodless revolution lay imminent. For him, it was a simple misdirection of efforts. The technological, material, and moral improvements of the city, or the urbe in this case, was the true source of public happiness and wealth. And with the arrival of 19th century technology, Serda saw that in his time, the culmination of the Enlightenment was close at hand. He says, quote, "Everything in this century is leading towards the disappearance of limits, towards a general merging, and everything tends towards peace." Do you have any questions about that?
He's right.
So in addition to the form that the theoria takes is unmistakably that of the utopian critique, also born of the Enlightenment. The temporal symmetry that structures the theoria is the signature of this form. He confidently calls the foundation of his endeavor La filosofía de historia de urbanización, philosophy of history of urbanization, I guess it's probably clear. A clear reference to Condorcet's stages of history. So history, according to Cerdá in his philosophy, can be understood through urbanization, and as such, history consists of five major eras, each determined completely by the period's technological means of human locomotion. So from pedestrian to equestrian to then drawn, then wheeled, and then finally in his era, steam-powered locomotion. The cause for Cerdá of urbanization, the historical force driving it, is Vialidad. By strictly removing himself from the burden of tradition, and thus of history, Cerdá is able to isolate his theory within an autonomous temporal framework, whose geometrical center is his present. The privileging of the present, untethered from an asymmetric tradition, then affords Cerdá a degree of freedom, which he asserts by unfolding in equal proportions both past and future. He writes, "The study and knowledge, or the past, of an illness, which the present, you could say, would be useless if they did not lead to the recognition and application of the remedy, or the future." This is the sort of framework structuring this teoria. In this way, the city appears as a pharmakon, at once a cause of society's illness and its cure. It is this conceptual crux on which Cerdá's utopian symmetry is able to stand. And from here, he makes a simple transposition from history to science, projecting a utopian past into the concrete future of urbanization, what we would now know as urbanism. Because history for Cerdá can be explained through the history of urbanization, the present condition of the city that he faces, the walled city, etc., can only be explained as a kind of historical perversion by the excesses of the absolutist state, a kind of dark digression from a more true history of human movement and cohabitation. Indeed, Cerdá is able to completely avoid the complexity of history precisely by inscribing the origin of urbanization outside of it, in the heart of humanity, as a product of man's natural instinct of sociability. Urbanization, he writes, starts with the first man, whose patrimony matters little to our objective, for we know that wherever man was, there was the first element or germ of urbanization. By drawing a line from man's instinct for sociability to the need for shelter, Cerdá can then extrapolate this genealogy to urbanization itself, a process whose endpoint is civilization. Urbanization, quote, led him to the state of society. It taught him culture. It civilized him. In a word, to the urbanization which was born with him and grew with him, man knows everything he is, everything he can be in this world. This alternate history overflows with the virtues of a reality governed by nature's providence, revealing that even throughout the many catastrophes and barbarian invasions, while civilizations may themselves be destroyed, urbanization, quote, has always marched forward along the path of its perfection, on which the Almighty chose not to set limits as he had done for the waves of the ocean. By construing urbanization as an innate social force and raising it above that of civilization, Cerdá depicts it as a kind of secularized catacomb, one whose history clearly displaces the Holy Roman Empire, the Catholic Church, and indeed the state, in their power to repel the barbaric eschaton, the end of the world. This founding constitution of urbanization, if you can call it that, the origin, is based on the fictional ahistorical figure of the noble savage, the natural man. And this is what marks the utopian foundation of Cerdá's theory. While certain theological overtones in this writing are evident, his concept of Vialidad reveals a truly messianic force. Vialidad is the central agency by which the perfection of humanity is to be achieved. So more than merely denoting circulation as a fact, Vialidad comes close to expressing the direct experience of the very life force of human production itself, an experience achievable through the act of unencumbered movement, exchange, and communication. In other words, through total urbanization. Because Vialidad is the very cause of urbanization, it would govern the design of each constituent element of the urbe. The urbe's overall organization is then determined first and foremost by the establishment of a network of ways. Then from there, its intersections, or what he calls nodes, would be worked out. And a systematic differentiation of modes of transport across the breadth of each street then would be determined. Curiously, the spaces left over by this network, the city blocks, or manzanas, he named tellingly intervias, or interways. As we see here. Yet this apparent triumph of circulation over building would not lead to an opposition between the two. Referring again to his utopian history, he bound the two realms together by considering the street to be more than just a public realm, to be an indispensable appendage of the house. In this way, while Validad clearly determines the urbe, endowing it with its raison d'etre, the intervia remains its fundamental unit. It is an urbe in miniature. The opposition between the two is resolved in this dialectic whole. The relationship between Validad and dwellings becomes clear. Dwellings, quote, are the ultimate terminal point, yet at one and the same time, they are the first starting points of the great universal Validad. Furthermore, he distinguishes a curious classification of ways that compose the urbe, not based on function alone, but rather on how they situate the individual in a kind of divine infrastructure. The highest order of these ways he calls, quote, transcendental, because they are derivations of the continuation of the great universal Vialidad. The second are urban, because they are at the immediate service of the urbe as a collective whole. And finally, the others are individual, intended to satisfy the needs of the individual family. So channeled through this hierarchy of ways, Vialidad is the dialectic agency through which the achievement of a kind of earthly form of transcendence circulates, both departing from and terminating in the private, isolated dwelling. In its secularized form, transcendence, in this way, no longer describes an active passage from one world to another. Rather, it articulates a means of connecting the individual with the immanent universality bound up in the sentient link between single-family dwelling and the totality of an urbanized society. Validad is the essence of this mystical power by which the individual paradoxically remains isolated in order to achieve the collectivity of such transcendence. So through Validad, Cerda envisioned a world civilized by and united in the freedom of unencumbered circulation. In a word, an urbanized world bearing no exterior to itself. The secularization of such theological notions is not limited to Cerda's use of transcendence alone. As with his Enlightenment predecessors, Cerda's entire understanding of progress, carried across his philosophy of history, bears the mark of a secularized eschatology. Yet while the evidence of this certainly shouldn't invalidate his work, it is precisely here where his utopian innocence reveals a politics at the core of the apparently apolitical project of urbanization. On the surface, urbanization can be read as a project for depoliticizing the city in the name of moral society, the 19th century in a sense. However, as we know, the heralding of a system governed by the rule of law, which Cerda's science of urbanization attempts to achieve, represents not the disavowal of the political, but rather its displacement into a legal totality. Through urbanization, Cerda provides a means by which the political monopoly of the state dissolves away into a kind of techno-legal administrative totality, a normative doctrine, in a way, whose power is in its ability to disguise its nonetheless political existence, while simultaneously extending its reach over the entire domestic space of life and its reproduction. He makes this move not by increasing the powers of the state itself, but rather by reducing the city to a single uniform social apparatus, an expanded domestic surface ordered according to life's ceaseless productive and reproductive functions. Vialidad, in this case, splits the concept of the urbe down the middle, disclosing on the one hand an external world of transcendental freedom from state domination, experienced in the network of ways, and on the other, an interior world of dwelling, overdetermined by state regulation, the primary site of its intervention. The hubris of Cerda was not in terms of the illegitimacy of secularizing a theological concept, but in the assumption that such a concept could displace the political, itself a secularized theological category. The secular, just as the theological, are both signatures whose apparent opposition belies the uniformity of power which passes through each. That Cerda reanimates theological concepts in the service of a secular project points not to an inconsistency, but rather to the political consistency at the heart of urbanization. Indeed, such a transposition assists only in the production of a myth which gives both material and theoretical credence to the notion of the total state, one in which the state is both nowhere and everywhere at once, the result of liberal and moralist utopian desire to neutralize the political entirely. In this way, transcendence is the myth of a passage from a world defined by the bourgeoisie and its political other, existing in the artifice of domination, to a world collapsed into a singular, self-enclosed universe, naturalized by technology and faded by scientific progress. A world of one gigantic urban society, which by its very conditions of uniformity precludes any such other. So to conclude, while Cerdà can be credited with neither fully realizing his project in Barcelona, nor for writing its first bylaws, his deep convictions for the political spirit of the day allowed him to construct a model far ahead of its time, anticipating a crude version of the legal, administrative, and governmental apparatuses that would accompany what has now become an anonymous global paradigm over a century later. As we know today, the city, or perhaps we can say the urbe, continues to be perceived simultaneously as poison and cure, as a pharmacon, allowing us to endlessly reproduce piecemeal reforms for the latest general crisis, all the while approaching Cerdà's vision of a singular interconnected urbe stretching across the entire globe. Perhaps the true crisis then lies in the fact that the city Cerdà imagined and the one we inhabit no longer gains resolution as a formal entity, but rather as an ongoing expansive process of nature, which can only be tamed by the opaque certainty of urbanization. That's it.
Okay, thanks very much, Ross. Eva, if you want to come back up here as well. Obviously, we want to take questions from the floor, and we'll have time for that in a minute. But I was wondering if I could just maybe just ask just quickly the three contributors to maybe step back a little bit, sorry, from your particular papers today, and just talk a little bit about where you see the causes for this kind of change in the industrial city, or this crisis in the industrial city, or the building form. Where do you think what are the motives for these examples that you talked about today? Eva.
You mean in this particular case?
Yeah. I mean, yes. Why is there this moment in the industrial city? Why are there these attempts to rethink institutions, etc.? What's
just look at this case, because I'm not familiar with other urban situations, but I think it was just stretched too far. It was the system treated the individual in a way that was not, that was beyond what could be taken, and therefore there was this need to reform. And I think they also understood that a revolution was a danger. Maybe they didn't understood it right then how close the revolution would be, but I think it was feared that there might be an uproar really coming unless there'd be an attempt to reform.
Okay, anti-revolution.
That's a tricky question to ask. Answer. I mean, obviously, the sort of fact of the history of capitalism and the sort of imbalance it created between the countryside and the city spurred on the massive growth, which caused a lot of sort of, again, factual problems to become visible. And I think that coincided with the invisibility of the political power of the rising bourgeoisie. So, I guess, I mean, yeah, it's a very long question. I don't know exactly where to start. So I think through a sort of the imminent factual scientific lens that people began to see the city operating as a kind of biological device, etc., I think there was a massive amount of effort put into conceptualizing the city anew, whether that be through reform or through completely renaming, reconceptualizing it altogether. So the city became a kind of hot topic.
Okay.
No, I totally agree with Ross, and by the way, I think that we can also rethink also the cause-effect kind of circle, because on the one hand, it's true that this kind of approach was, of course, an output of a situation of huge pressure. But on the other hand, I think that the kind of epistemological circle, if you want, works also the other way around. Because some of the concepts that actually spurred the shift in the nature of the city actually predated the industrial city. So for example, the concept of population had been around already for some 200 years. So there are also political and I would say cultural, epistemological, really large scale shifts that actually almost caused the precondition for the industrial revolution. This is what I mean, that you can even see it the other way around. The development of the science of statistics, for example, that kick-started basically the biopolitical era, if you want. We can see it the other way around, that it's not the industrial revolution that has triggered biopolitics, but rather than the growth of the biopolitical paradigm has enabled maybe industrialization to happen. So I think that it's a very interesting and ambiguous actually relationship between these concepts like population statistics and really the kind of loss of meaning of the subject of the individual into the wider concept of population, whether this is the cause or the result, actually, of industrialization.
Okay, questions, please? On the floor? Gentleman over here. Oh, no, it's behind you. Yes. I'll come to everybody, don't worry. Yes.
So it seems to me that both Russ...
Can you hear?
Hi. So it seems to me that both Ross and Maria are on rather parallel tracks, but the claims seem to depart quite radically. There seems to be a strong divergence and an inconsiderate hardness, which strikes me as a kind of, a critique based sort of fundamentally in materialism, and Ross's sort of eschatology, which posits a sort of transcendental eschatology, which is technology somehow that mediates between man and nature and is our ultimate sort of the thing that leads us to this kind of happy forever after. And I wonder about the two readings of Cerda, whether they can be reconciled in that sense.
I think that they are not far. Actually, I don't see a contrast between the two things, because actually that's precisely my point, that while Cerda usually is seen as this kind of, very generic, very extremely blunt kind of interpretation of managerial greed, actually it's not. So I totally agree. I agree with Ross on that. Of course, his reading started more from this kind of messianic kind of task, let's say, of the urbanist, of this budding figure of the urbanist. Mine is more. I was more interested in reading what kind of archetypes he. Basically, Cerda articulated, that is one of the many archetypes that he articulated is the idea of the Roman city. It's not the only one, it's the one that I wanted to show today, but I think that I totally agree with him. I mean, I really think that there are two layers, the layer of how the project looks like and what actually it wants to do are two different things. So I really agree with this kind of messianic utopian. I said it myself that it's a highly utopian project. That's also why it kind of failed.
But it's apolitical, whereas you return continually throughout the course of your presentation to reference a subject or a subjectivity within the city, whereas Ross, as far as I know, that you're interested primarily in Cerda's orientation towards technological progress as a kind of divine prime mover that will sort of...
I wouldn't want to say that it's an apolitical discourse. In fact, I'd say that it's being apolitical makes it almost by default political.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
The use of technology is sort of means to kind of cover this over and to, and the sort of legal totality of the doctrine that he created. I mean, you can read it itself as a sort of social contract, a sort of newer edition of a social contract. I mean, it's highly politicized. So in a way, that's kind of the core of my thesis here.
I totally agree on that. It's really a new kind of social contract. It's this thing that it's not the Ciudad anymore, it's the urbe. He says it very clearly, so it's...
I asked them to disagree, but I couldn't get them to. Okay. Question?
In fact, I'd like to follow on with this, because I also found that the two presentations, I mean, I think, first of all three presentations did have one common, in one way or another, one common theme that was dealing with the relationship of subject to context in a way that it was present in all three of the presentations. But I also found that Maria talked about not only Cerda, but certainly also about Cerda, but I found that both Maria's and Ross's presentations not only did not overlap, but I think in some ways were complementary. I mean, it's almost as if they'd been prepared in some kind of mutual preparation, which I think was, and I do agree with you that, you know, and in fact, you actually even intimated that kind of the apolitical nature was by default political, yeah. You know, kind of the messianic aspect. To Maria, I have a question, but before I go, because that's the only question I have, so before I go into that, I'll say a few things about Eva's. I think that it's an extremely good subject to have been chosen for, and something that we need to see treated by an architect. I say that because, I mean, it has been dealt with by Foucault, and the kind of parallel of the topic being dealt with, you know, this kind of the receptacle of the outsider, you know, that in the sense that the deceased is the outsider, you know, and I think that in order to somehow make it complementary or differentiate it from Foucault's, because it follows very much kind of a similar line of thought, is on the one hand a very thorough visual documentation, which I can see you are working on, kind of, and on the other hand, I wonder whether you could also look into the so-called improvement of the situation of bringing in the relationship of the hospital to the context, to the city, whether there is any kind of analogical investigation that you could make on contemporary conditions using the same criteria, and what conclusions you can draw by just kind of looking at the kind of present day, if you like, perhaps not so much or including the idea of the hospital, but also looking at the idea of how society treats the outsider today, and how does the outsider circulate or delve within this urban environment. And I think it would be a nice extension to the thesis. To Maria, I just want to kind of after the exclamation mark at the end of your presentation, your indictment of the post-humanist city, are we to interpret that as going to the Renaissance city, or?
No, I don't know. One thing that I know is that I don't think that we can somehow go back. And to make a very unpopular, if you want, reference that I guess is also something that you read to Carl Schmitt, there is a sort of shift in the reference center of human activity at large, you know, that has been from the theological to the humanistic to the economic. And unfortunately or fortunately, we are still in an age that is ruled by the economic paradigm. So whatever kind of solution we want to find out of this flattening of the subject, that, let's be frank, nobody likes it, of course. I think it has to be somehow within this kind of economic paradigm, because architecture itself cannot shift the reference center to something else. So, yeah.
Yeah, because both I mean, both Osman and Cerda are kind of the apotheosis of the emancipation of mercantile society,
yes,
after the French Revolution.
Yes.
And it's just a kind of logical conclusion, is mercantile society.
Absolutely.
The apotheosis of which is the market of, I mean, it's the market.
It's the market.
What we live today, the kind of neoliberal kind of conditions of the market, which now has reached its apotheosis.
Well, so to make another reference to Carl Schmitt, okay, again, unpopular, but basically what he had against the economic stage for him was the fact that economy for him cannot be represented, because since it doesn't have any kind of value, you know, it's kind of value-free, and in this, weirdly enough, it converges with Zimmer, that said basically the same thing, that there are, I mean, economy is indifferent to values, to transcendental values, so it cannot be represented. So for Carl Schmitt, the problem with the economical era is that, it was impossible to create a fitting representation of something that is basically fluid, no? And I think that, of course, representation means putting limits, means, creating boundaries, creating form, and unfortunately or fortunately, architecture needs form. So the question really is architectural form possible in this realm of fluidity? And I think that the stage as we are now, it almost seems like it's not possible, because I think that Ross's diagram in the end, I think it was very significant in linking these two conditions, that we are going towards this kind of direction in which it seems that the more fluid, the more kind of slippery the thing is, the better. And of course, we could give a very simple answer and say, yes, we have to go back to the Renaissance city, we have to retreat. But hopefully, I still hope that something can come out of the... which I don't know yet, but I think that there is hope at least in these two projects in creating a certain friction. Because, you know, my problem with the whole story is these kind of projects that have no friction, they are even impossible to criticize. I mean, how do you criticize this OMA thing? It's impossible, it makes sense, right? So I think that in the kind of what I find interesting in Inconsiderate Hardness is that at least it creates a grip that you can then criticize, you can even criticize very harshly. Because personally, I totally don't sympathize with Hosan, but at least you can create a kind of consciousness.
Yeah, I thought Doug might want to pick up on that one.
I'm not actually going to ask the question you thought I was going to ask.
He's writing critique of
thanks very much for three fantastic presentations. I'll probably want to have conversations with all of you at some point afterwards. But the thing that really struck me... was something that occurred to me in your presentation, Maria, which was it's kind of about the question of what's the difference in the types of subjectivity between those produced in Paris and those produced in Barcelona. And I ask that because I think that this notion of looking at the landscape as something which in both cases is imported and becomes a kind of city or an urban model is very significant because of the different types.
Yes.
that with Paris, it's Le Notre's landscape. Yes, it's kind of Baroque, and it's very much based on, it's on the production of vision and monumentalism and symbolism and the like. Whereas with Ciudad Barcelona, it's about kind of, you know, a more kind of quotidian, productive, agricultural landscape. And my immediate thoughts on perhaps some of the one of the key differences is that if we consider that one of the rationalizations for that kind of that stage of the remaking of Paris mm-hmm. was the uprisings of 1848.
Of course.
But in everything they tried to do, we could say, although it might have been some kind of long-term success in terms of the society of the spectacle, it's an immediate failure because that very production of symbols and spaces is in through the Paris Commune is
exactly.
Presents a means to oppose it. Whereas in Ciudad Barcelona, those symbols are largely absent, and he says they don't need to be there because we have nothing to symbolize because we're
exactly.
already democratic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that I'm perhaps asking for some more stuff that's in your PhD, So my question is, what do you understand in terms of the different productions of subjectivity?
No, I totally agree. And by the way, I think that there is you are making an important point when you're talking about landscape and two different conceptions of landscape, because something that I didn't mention because I want to leave up open for discussion is the difference between landscape and environment. And there is a difference between these two concepts, because of course landscape, especially in English, is a word that has been reintroduced through the Dutch language in more or less 1700, and it referred really to the paintings. So it's something that is somehow, it has an inherently visual kind of connotation. While environment is a much more inclusive, if you want, concept that has got to do also with culture, with the way people relate, and it's much more vague, if you want, but also inclusive. And I think that the main difference, if I have to really have a one-liner between Hosman and Serda, is that Hosman was absolutely not interested at all in the ethos of the people that were living in his city. And I think in this respect, the picture of the bar made by Manet is really significant. I mean, there is no ethical judgment whatsoever. Well, on the contrary, as Ross was pointing out, the ethical question was extremely important in Serda's case and was really at the root of this idea of educating the people and you know, offering them a subjectivity that was, yes, generic, but not devoid of ethos. And that's why I sympathize personally much more, of course, with Serda than with Hosman.
I think
that covers it.
Okay, good. I've realised I haven't really been talking about Eva's paper, and I was wondering whether you want to comment on the relationship between these economic forces, this neoliberal agenda, or what have you, and the role of the medical institution. Do you want to say, how do you see it? Is neoliberalism absolute? Are there any fissures and cracks in capitalism? Or?
No, I think I'm not equipped to. Let's say I think there are better people on the table to respond to. Mm.
Okay, all right. Okay.
Completely.
Questions?
Marine. Going back to the perhaps also to relate or trying to give a possible answer on behalf of Eva, going back to the first question that Maria posed, the relation. That's what I'm doing. So,
that
is better? Yeah. Okay. Going back to the initial question that Maria posed, the relationship between the subject and the context, because in the end, I think that perhaps may start disclosing some cracks in that absolute system. I think that it's not when you say that okay we move from cité to herbs and oops it's more designating a material grouping of buildings rather than a community of citizens. And nevertheless, you are talking about new forms of subjectivity and in one way almost a mise en scène of the subject.
Yes.
And in one way, you ended by posing the question of the possible experience of the spaces. And I don't think that was really addressed in the discussion of the paper. That's why I guess I was going back to what Elias asked about what you mean by humanist city.
Is the question to me?
Okay. First, and then yeah.
Well, I think that, I mean, it's somehow I think that it's different to imagine a city in which that is still conceived as somehow a point of intensity of and values and human activity, and imagining the city landscape or city environment that in a way is not an exception anymore, but is simply part of a sort of kind of productive, if you want, kind of continuum that ideally, you know, expands. And I think that, I mean, the issue of the post-humanist or post-humanist for me, if we look at urbanism, not at, now I'm really about architecture, I don't think it's the place to talk about that, especially if you talk about Barcelona, that is extremely, you know, flexible in terms of architecture while it's really an urban plan. But on that level, it's really, for me, it has to do with this relationship between city and non-city. And really, the humanist city is still seen as the seat, somehow, of some sort of transcendental value. Even Serda puts a lot of transcendental values in it, absolutely, because I totally agree with Ross on that, but they are not located in the city. They are more located in this kind of in this urbanization that ideally would cover the whole globe. And I think that as far as urbanism is concerned, the shift between humanist and post-humanist is this. I mean, the kind of erasure of any kind of idea of exceptional. the city is not exceptional anymore in the territory. Certain places in the city are not exceptional anymore in comparison with certain others. And you were mentioning before, for example, Mirceliade, and I think he makes a very interesting discussion of the sacred, how the sacred from a spatial plan has transferred into a time-based kind of horizon. Because there are no more spaces that are sacred. There are maybe certain days that are sacred, but no more places that hold that kind of significance. And that's, I think, the shift that we are really making from theological to humanistic to economical time frames, in which really the difference are more and more blurred. Mm-hmm. It's kind of this, let's say, the planting of discrimination. In the end, I would really agree with Zimmel. The key point of a post-humanist city is really this kind of planting of discrimination, in which you can make less and less differences, let's say.
And the erasure of limits.
The erasure of limits is the key, I think, yeah, of course.
In the sense that there is possibility for the infinite extension, but exactly. I think at the same time there were other kind types of limits or interfaces which were introduced in
absolutely.
Order to regulate and control
absolutely.
That system. Because in one
absolutely.
Way, that's the first reading of that, that's this constant flow and openness and infinite
yeah,
extension.
It's not
or possibility of infinite extension.
Absolutely.
But as I say, and I think the concept of realidad is very
yeah.
captures all these different, both spatial and temporal dimensions.
Dimension.
That history, which is a constant flow, a process, yeah. and it's a kind of movement towards
mm-hmm.
perfection, towards the future,
yeah.
a progress, and which being has was translated in the city as this kind
yeah.
of continuing uninterrupted circulation, flow
mm-hmm.
of people, money,
yeah.
Commodities,
potential.
And so on. But at the same time, I think there is an introduction of other limits and interfaces,
absolutely.
And I think ever. Demonstrated how the medical institution
yeah.
actually was one of these interfaces
yeah.
which are to kind of differentiate
yeah.
but also kind of regulate the relationship between the individual
mm-hmm.
and the population.
Mm-hmm.
I totally agree. I think that fluidity is one of the biggest myths and rhetorics that we have
yeah.
been fed by,
yes.
Let's be very blunt, by capitalism
yes. yeah.
to believe that, that this kind of plan is completely smooth, while it's not true. Because I think that really Eva's presentation made this very clear. We are not in a smooth world, as much as we can believe in it, even naively or
mm-hmm.
in wishful thinking manner as Serda, but that's not true, of course.
Yeah. To respond to that, there certainly are new kind of barriers that
mm-hmm.
erupt in the space that Serda creates, sort of evacuation of all barriers it purports to do. And I think, through this notion of vialidad, you see that right down the middle, where on one hand you have the circulation in the streets and everything, but what he called vialidad also encompassed circulation of fluids, et cetera, below ground as well. So
yes.
the evacuation of waste, et cetera,
yes.
The supply of water. And what you see in that division of above and below ground vialidad is really a sort of new barrier, what I call a functional separation between the spaces of production and the spaces of reproduction.
Yeah.
Space of reproduction being in the via, in the intervia, in the house, the individual
yes,
dwelling.
Exactly.
I mean, this follows very much the paradigm of immunization that Esposito speaks about, where constantly these barriers are becoming more and more internalized,
exactly.
And this notion of transcendence occurs somehow within the subject rather than somehow out of it. So.
Yeah, ultimately it's the ego of the subject that gets, if the barriers are not outside, they have to be inside
yeah.
somewhere.
Questions?
Okay.
I'll give you another one.
I apologize in advance, but I'll make it quick. I had to think about it because the first question was kind of off point, and now I think I understand a little better. So it seems to me as if, Ross, you're sort of comfortable in autonomy outside of history, and as such, it's this kind of the kind of secularizing of a theology, right? Which meant to many who have read Schmitt would seem to suggest a kind of sovereign force, right? Something
mm-hmm.
that is solely capable of deciding on or making the decision, the exception. But for Maria, it seems to me where that breaks down is that the production of material space is the production of limits that can be confronted. And that's where the system itself, this force outside of history, which you're interested in, Ross, begins to break down, because it's the political subjectivity that reacts against the hospital or the things brought to the fringe of the city that are imminently perceivable. And it seems to me that's where you two part, and I think that might be the danger too, in putting too much stock in the kind of fantasies of a technocrat, which is essentially what this guy was. And you know, he was ostensibly an apolitical kind of agent of the system, and he it was in his best interest to avoid politics. Whereas I think Maria, politics begins to emerge again as this thing that breaks down the reproducibility of this idea.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, to say he's an apolitical, I mean, it's a bit of a slippery thing because he's a liberal. He's a sort of steadfast liberal of his time, which, you know, he sees politics as a sort of vestige of a past that needs to be forgotten. But nevertheless, you know, we all know that liberalism itself is a political paradigm. And I think in that case, his sort of apolitical stance really articulates the very political foundation of what he's proposing.
Okay.
Yeah.
And take another question. Just one more.
I think that should be the last one, because we need to...
Yeah, if we just
take one more, it's... Yeah, hello, Thilo from the Bartlett. A question for Eva. I wonder how you would respond from your research to the discussion that is in the room about subjectivity. I wonder how much subjectivity the patients in your hospitals can claim for themselves. And so that would be one question. And the second is, can you extend a little bit more on this shift that you're indicating, that first, because I know the hygiene, you know, is also the discourse of both of the urban projects, and I wonder if either at that time there was a hygienic discourse on the city, I think that's what Murray asked, or when does this shift occur from, you know, something treated within the hospital and then the city becomes the object of the hygienic discourse? Again, a big question.
Very much. I think I have to make this difference that my focus of my PhD thesis actually is much later, which is in modernism, and an answering from there would be much easier, I think, than answering from this paper. However, I think. I'm not sure about your last question. You know, it's a bit sort of a chicken and egg question. Yeah? What came first? Was it? I think the point that I wanted to make was that it really started from this one building, and this building was the problem. And what exactly happened in this building was considered as a huge problem. And I think then people started thinking about this building also being at different places, you know, maybe not such a in such a problematic environment, but equal almost. And then I think they started thinking in networks. I don't think they started to conceptualize the city first and then treat the problem.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Eva. Okay, I think that's it. We're going to wrap up now. Just want to say thank you again to Maria, Eva, and Ross for three excellent papers, and for the excellent discussion afterwards. Thank you.